So many familiar faces. Thank you all for coming this evening also. We're supposed to talk about Lord Shiva today, because it's Shiva Ratri. Now, this particular kind of weather is actually ideal for Shivaratri. In fact, if we truly want to honor Lord Shiva, we should be holding class outside. Any volunteers? Because there we go, one more. Two, three. Mahadev, he lives on Mount Kailash. And one of Parvati Mata's most persistent complaints about their domestic life is that even though he is the master of all the three worlds, they have no roof over their heads. We consider it to be a duty of a householder to provide shelter for their families, and yet Lord Shiva lives under a tree on Mount Kailash covered with snow. Since moving to Utah, I know what that experience is like. We live on mountains covered with snow, except with nice warm heat and nice homes. So Lord Shiva is very much a mountain dweller in cold weather. Our goal today is to describe a little bit about what makes him so wonderful and what makes him unique. Different. We're devotees of Krishna, and so often we don't say so much about Lord Shiva. And yet, Lord Shiva is so very important for Krishna himself and for all devotees of Lord Krishna that at least once a year, on the evening of Mahashivratri, we should take an opportunity to think about Lord Shiva and all the different ways in which he helps us and helps us come to Krishna. All the ways in which he's glorified and described in the pages of Srimad Bhagavatam also. There's a famous verse in Bhagavad Gita where Krishna says that he is the seed-giving father for all living entities. He says, Aham Bija Pradapita. I am the seed-giving father. He is the source of all things and all living beings. But in the pages of Bhagavatam, Srila Prabhupada explains that when Krishna says that, I am the seed-giving father, he means Lord Shiva is the seed-giving father. There's a wonderful verse in begins Kalidasa's Kumara Sambhava, where you know Kalidasa, famous poet from India. Like, people often call him India Shakespeare, although Shakespeare was England's Kalidasa. wonderful poet, and he begins his poem by saying Jagata Pitaro Vande Parvati Parameshwara. I offer my obeisances, Vande, to Jagata Pitaro, the parents of this whole universe, Parvati and Parameshwara, Parvati and Mahadev, Lord Shiva. So, what is Lord Shiva and how is he different? How is he unique? We know of so many different devas. There's Indra, there's Varuna, there's Vayu, there's all these different demigods who are there. And these demigods, we read in the scriptures, that they are like you and me. They're living entities who have been given particularly powerful posts in the government, in the bureaucracy of this universe. One looks after the rain, one looks after the wind and the sun, and so on. They look after different elements, but anyone could become Indra if they were qualified enough, with proper performance of yajna and good karma and things like that. So, therefore they're called demigods. Now we sometimes use the same word for Lord Shiva also. But can any one of us become Lord Shiva?
No.
We cannot. Can we become Brahma?
No.
Yes.
We can become Brahma. Can we become Indra?
Yes.
We can become all of them, in fact. But we cannot become Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva is unique. The reason for that is because he is basically Krishna, but different. So here's how it works. Krishna, he's up there in the spiritual world, in Golok Vrindavan, playing his flute, tending the cows, and his primary worry in life is that Mother Yashoda might be upset with him, or Radharani is, where is she, and why is she upset with him? This is his primary concern. Krishna is Lila Purushottam. He spends all of his time enjoying with his devotees. In fact, the job of creation, of dealing with this material world, is not his concern at all. It's like someone having to deal with taking out the garbage in your house. Right? It's a domestic chore. We have to do it. But if you could hire someone to do it, you'd hire someone to do it for you. Right? To take out the trash, to shovel your snow. These are things that we like to give away to other people. Right? Mowing the lawn, shoveling the snow, taking out the trash. We'd enjoy handing it to someone else, hiring someone. Now, Krishna, being God, he doesn't have to take care of this aspect of creation. This material world is the prison house. It's the rejects of the universe. We're outcasts, and Krishna doesn't have to deal with the prison. He's got better things to do. He has to deal with law-abiding citizens who live there. But he's got a department to take care of that, the Department of Corrections, that deals with all of us. He doesn't have to do it himself. In fact, he never comes in contact with Maya Devi, Bhagavatam says. She always stands at a safe distance, bashfully, embarrassed, because she's got the unpleasant, the thankless task, Prabhupada says, of taking care of those who are criminals, those who are rebellious. She takes care of us and keeps us in the material world because we want to be here. So Krishna doesn't have anything to do with the material world. With the process of creation, even, with creating this material world, we think of God as creator, as Jagatkarta. But actually, according to the scriptures, that it's not a task befitting God. Creation is actually something that is not really God's job at all. Even though every religion in the world talks about God as creator. But really, that's not a task befitting him. It's like asking the CEO of a company to go out into the field and lay bricks and mortar to build their next office. No, he's going to approve the plans and that's it. He's going to have a crew to do this for him. Krishna doesn't lay brick and mortar. He doesn't stand there and say, now let's create this, let's create that. He is untouched by Maya. But then, of course, he also cares about us. He's our father. And so when he does need to do something for us, for the material world, to create it, to deal with it, to manipulate this material world, to take care of business here, he makes an expansion as Mahavishnu. And he lies on the ocean, on the causal ocean. And what is the one action that he does in order to create this world? What's the one thing that Mahavishnu does? Now there's two things actually. He breathes. So that's how much effort God puts into creation. He breathes. That's it. Right? How much effort does that take? He breathes out all the universes. So this is why I'm saying, he's not a brick and mortar laying type of God. No. He is breathing. That's all he does for creation. And one more thing, before he actually even breathes. He glances, he looks. Who does he glance on? Maya Devi. That's as much contact as he has with material energy, is he glances. He looks at her. And in this way, all the living entities are born. Bhagavatam says he impregnates Maya Devi with all the living entities, with all the jivas, and she gives birth to them. Because Krishna is angani yasya sakalendriya. That's all he needs to do, is just glance. But of course, we all know that management doesn't work like that. Right? If you're a completely aloof, hands-off type of manager, and you have nothing to do with the people you are managing, and you're not willing to go down onto the site with them and get your hands dirty, you're not going to last as a manager. That kind of imperial rule, that's what an autocrat does. But a real successful manager can't do that. So Krishna knows this too. The world needs a father, needs a practical maintainer. And so he actually decides to contact, to touch, to engage with the material energy, with Maya. Even though he doesn't have to, even though he particularly doesn't want to even, we're after all the troublemakers. There's three quarters of the creation is there, all wonderful devotees. But still he does, right? Because he cares. And the moment he contacts this material energy, the moment he touches her, he becomes Lord Shiva. He becomes Mahadeva. Kshiram yatha tadivikara vishesha yoga. Beautiful examples given by Lord Brahma in Brahma Samhita. He says how when milk, Lord Krishna is like milk, Lord Shiva is like yogurt. Yogurt is a product of milk. When milk contacts culture, yes, you add some culture into it, usually by some other yogurt or something else, some culturing process, it comes in contact with that acidophilus and bifidus and whatever else those bacteria are, that milk becomes transformed into yogurt. When Krishna comes in contact with material energy, this is acidophilus, bifidus, etc., the bacteria, comes in contact with material energy, he turns into Lord Shiva. Now, are milk and yogurt the same thing? Yes. They're both dairy. Yes. They're both dairy. They're identical. But no. They're not identical. You can't use the recipe you use for milk, you can't use it for yogurt, and yogurt you can't use for milk. Right? They're not interchangeable. They have completely different functions. If you have diarrhea, then in India they give you rice mixed with yogurt. Now if you were to drink 3 glasses of milk when you have diarrhea, so it means that the functions are different, they're not interchangeable, even though they are the same thing. There's a Srila Bhaktivedanta Saraswati Thakur in his purport to this verse, he says, very nice, he says, where did it go? So here's the verse. Kshiram yatha tadivikara vishesha yoga sanjayate nahi tatha pritagasti heto yasham bhutam abhitatha samupaita karya govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami. Just as milk is transformed into curd by the action of acids, but yet the effect curd is neither same as nor different from its cause, that is milk. So I adore the primeval Lord Govinda, of whom the state of Shambhu, or Shiva, is a transformation for the performance of the work of destruction. And then in the purport, Bhaktivedanta Saraswati Thakur says, Shambhu is not a second Godhead other than Krishna. Those who entertain such discriminating sentiment commit a great offense against the Supreme Lord. The supremacy of Shambhu is subservient to that of Govinda, hence they are not really different from each other. So, it's a contradiction. Yes, they are same, but they're also different. This is bheda-bheda. That they're identical, but they're also different. In what way are they the same? Well, Basically, they're the same nature of Godhead. The Godhead, or the category of God, is actually a very big category. In that category, you have all the different avatars of Lord Vishnu, Rama and Nrisimha and Vamana and Varaha. You have Lord Shiva is present in that. You have all the expansions of the Lord, Mahavishnu, Kshirodakshaya Vishnu, Garbhodakshaya Vishnu. So many people are there. And Lord Shiva is in that category. He is Godhead. He is Shiva Tattva. He's a unique aspect of God, particularly to engage with Maya Devi, with material energy. But he's not the supreme personality of Godhead. That phrase is very important that Prabhupada gives us. He is a personality of Godhead. He's a person, and he's part of Godhead. He's part of this category. But he's not the supreme personality of Godhead. Just like we're all citizens of this country or this state. But we're not the supreme in that category. There's the chief amongst us, okay, we could say the governor or the president, whatever it might be. That category is unique. That it belongs to Krishna only. Krishna stu Bhagavan Swayam. Govindam Adi Purusham, he is describing. Adi Purusha. He is the first and the best in that category, the supreme personality of God. But Shiva is in the category of God. This is not true about Brahma, it's not true about Indra or Varuna, it's not true about any of us, but it is true about Lord Shiva. This is how Shiva is the same. How is he different? They're both dairy. Why is Lord Shiva yogurt and not milk?
Yogurt cannot be turned into milk.
Yeah.
But milk can be turned into yogurt.
Right, it's unidirectional. Mm-hmm. You can go from Krishna to Lord Shiva. Krishna can do everything Lord Shiva can, but Lord Shiva cannot do everything Krishna can. One directional. What is it that Lord Shiva... What is it that is the exclusive domain of Lord Krishna? What is the difference between the two?
Krishna plays with his devotees only, that is his main function. Lord Shiva's function is destruction of the...
Yeah. Lord Shiva, in his role, he is in charge of the material world. Krishna is in charge of the spiritual world. Yes? So if we're looking for a better condition in the material world, Lord Shiva is a great person to go to. Because he's in charge of handing out all the leniencies in the prison, of giving you parole, of all kinds of things he can do. But ultimately, he cannot pardon. That role of giving liberation, of giving moksha, is reserved for Mukunda. Mukunda means the one who gives moksha, for liberation. Because he can even show you the path out. Like I said, he can give you parole. He can show you, he can even open the door for you. Yes? But only Krishna can let you into the spiritual world. The keys to the spiritual world belong to Krishna. The keys to the material world belong to Lord Shiva. That means Lord Shiva is very, very important because he can unlock this door. If we know how to deal with him properly, which we'll talk about in just a minute, he can unlock this door. But we need Lord Krishna to open the other door, to get from the material world to the spiritual world. Now, how do we get Lord Shiva to unlock the door? What is the proper way of understanding dealing with Lord Shiva? Like Ravana did? Is that a good model for worship of Lord Shiva? Ravana was a great devotee of Lord Shiva. He went to just to the base of Mount Kailash, and he prayed to Lord Shiva there for so many, such a long time. He even demonstrated his strength. You know that story? He lifted Mount Kailash, and the whole thing was shaking. And Mahadev was amused by this. Parvati Devi was not, but he was amused. And so Lord Shiva, he pushed his toe into the ground, and the whole thing became so heavy that Ravana's hands became caught under the mountain, and he got crushed. And so with his hands stuck there, he recited the hundreds of beautiful prayers for Lord Mahadev. This is why Lord Shiva is called Mahadev, because he's not like an ordinary Dev. He's Mahadev, right? He's greater than all the others. So Ravana is not a good model for worship of Lord Shiva. You see, Lord Shiva, he's accompanied, there's two types of beings who worship him. Two categories of living beings in this universe who worship Lord Shiva. Anyone know what they are? What are the two types? If you go visit Lord Shiva, you'll find two types of beings hanging out. Who are they?
Ghosts.
One are ghosts, spirits, demons, goblins, people like that. And the other?
Who wants material desire?
Yogis. The best of yogis. He's called, one of Lord Shiva's names is Yogishwar, the Lord of all the yogis. Those who are very self-realized. They go, they surround. Lord Shiva, you see, is always there. He's meditating. He's there in this posture of yoga, eyes half closed, in lotus position. So all the best yogis come to learn yoga from him with the view of achieving liberation. Those two categories come to worship Lord Shiva. Why the ghosts and goblins? Well, one of Lord Shiva's qualities. See, Lord Shiva, he's a very, very unique personality. He's very contradictory in his nature. If you study the character of Lord Shiva, he's very contradictory. On the one hand, he is... some of his contradictions. On the one hand, he is the most auspicious personality in this world, like Madhumbhava was saying at the beginning. The very word Shiva means good fortune, of auspiciousness. So he's the most auspicious personality, and all the great yogis come to be with him for this reason. On the other hand, he hangs out with the most inauspicious beings in this creation. No one likes to spend time with ghosts. If you ever have a ghost in your house, it's not a pleasant experience. So he doesn't like it. No one likes it. But he stays with ghosts, goblins. He spends his evenings, his nights, you know where? Crematoriums, graveyards. He covers himself with ash from where? Not your kitchen fire. From funeral pyres. From the burning of dead bodies. He covers himself with that. And this is all very inauspicious. Very contradictory personality. Why? Why is he doing this? Why is he hanging out with such inauspicious people, considering that he is Shiva? Because of his compassion, his kindness. As the greatest devotee of the Lord, he's also very, very compassionate at heart. And he accepts under his wing, under his shelter, those creatures who are unwanted anywhere in this universe, who are universal rejects. Even snakes and serpents are still light in their own families, and with their own type of beings. They have a home, they have a place to go to, they have habitats. But these creatures, who are disembodied, ghosts and pishachas and the rakshasas and so on, ghosts don't come in families. They don't have any connections. They're rejected by anyone in this world. And those are the people Lord Shiva says, come, be with me. Just by that association, they become gradually purified of that condition and can then go on in their journey of taking a proper material body and progressing. He's very auspicious, at the same time he's very inauspicious. I mean, he's surrounded by inauspicious things. Lord Shiva is the creator Yes, we just talked about him as the father of all living entities. He brings this world into creation. And yet, at the same time, he is destroyed. Again, contradictory. When Lord Shiva does his Tandava dance, the whole world is wrapped up. It's destroyed by this dance. Isn't this such a wonderful way to think of destruction? Means if you think of multiple ways of destroying something, right? If you think, come destroy this house, right? Demolish it. What do you think of? Well, bulldozers and chainsaws and crowbars and dynamite. Yeah, you think of all of that. A very coarse and destructive process. But Lord Shiva, he destroys by dancing. What a wonderful way to destroy something. To dance with so much enthusiasm. He's got his damaru in one hand. He keeps time. Because at that point, there's no orchestra for him. So he has his own drum and then the rhythm of his feet to keep him time. And this way he's called Nataraja, the king of dancers. And he dances and he dances. One hand has fire and one hand has the damaru. And with the fire he burns, and with the hand he is keeping time as he dances. And this way he destroys everything. But this is not an evil act. This process of destruction is not evil. In the Vedic culture, we don't think of destruction as something evil. Rather, it's an essential part of the process of creation. Just like forest fires. There was a time when the National Park Service put out every forest fire that occurred in national parks like Yellowstone or Yosemite or places like that. We used to do this. Now we don't anymore. They let those fires burn. As long as they stay contained, they don't threaten human property or go too far out of bounds, they let them burn. And so some years ago, it's been a decade, I think Yellowstone had one of its biggest fires. And for years, you'd go there and you'd see all the trees were gone. It was all blackened, it was burnt. You think, why did they stop this? Because the forest fire is essential to the survival of the forest. Without the fire on a regular basis, that comes through lightning, it's naturally caused. Right? Without the fire, the forest cannot grow, it cannot become healthy. You know what the fire does? It sweeps through the forest, it breaks open certain types of seeds that are encased in hard shells and can only break open when the heat of fire pops them open and allows those trees to grow. It clears out the undergrowth, the underbrush, when it becomes too dense with foliage and creepers and so on and dead trees falling down below. New seeds fall, they can't take root because there's too much stuff there. It cleans it up by burning all of that away. It gets rid of the larger, older trees that are mostly just dead timber and allows fresh trees to grow. Otherwise, they have no chance at getting any sunlight when all the big trees are standing there. So many reasons why forest fires are essential for the health of the forest. People look at Lord Shiva and they think of his role of destruction. They think, oh, this is not good. But no, this is essential. He serves an essential role. To keep this universe, this world healthy. Now, often in India, we have this idea, right, of Brahma as creator, Vishnu as maintainer, preserver, and Shiva as destroyer, the Trimurti idea, and Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. And anytime you hear about Hinduism outside, they say, well, what do Hindus believe in? Well, we believe in the Trimurti, Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, creator, preserver, destroyer. But this idea is actually not shastrically supported. It's there. You talk here about Trimurti every once in a while. But the idea, you know, it was created just a couple hundred years ago when the British were ruling India and all these Christian missionaries were there. And, you know, there's the Christian doctrine of the Trinity, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So the Hindus didn't want to, they were looking for ways of justifying their religion. So, oh, we're not stupid. We're also like you. We're also bright and intelligent. See, we also have a Trinity. Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva. And this idea of Trimurti as the essence of Hinduism became strong at that time. That, oh, there's this. But actually, if you study the scriptures, then Lord Shiva, does he create? Yes. Does he destroy? Yes. Does he preserve?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Yes. When? Not so often, not as much as Lord Vishnu does. But when does he do this?
Save from the poison.
From the poison. The churning of the ocean. And all this, in that story, Lord Vishnu is helping them from start to finish, practically, in that story. I think last time I came, I told the story in detail. But he's helping in all ways. He becomes Kurma and he lifts the mountain and he helps them churn and he lifts the mountain, brings it to the ocean. So many things he does. But when the poison comes out, they all come crying to him again. And Lord Vishnu says, no, don't come to me. For this we go to Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva knows how to deal with these problematic substances. You go there.
Control
substances. He knows. Lord Shiva is always wrapped with, decorated with snakes, with serpents. He hangs out in crematoriums and covers himself with ash. All of these things, impure and improper and poisonous and dangerous, this is Lord Shiva's department. He takes care of the material world. He knows how to deal with the prison house and all the poison that comes from it. Go pray to him. And all the devas, they go and they offer beautiful prayers. They're here in Bhagavatam. You can recite them for Shivratri. They offer beautiful prayers to Lord Mahadev. And praise him as the one who protects all living entities. After all, he created them. He's their father. Jagata Pitaro Mande. He's their father. So he wants to look after them, like any father. And so he drinks all of this poison, and it flows down his throat, but stops right there. He holds it in his throat, so it doesn't go into the rest of his body. But the poison is so powerful, hala poison, that it turns his throat blue, or black. This is why it's called Nilakanta. So he's auspicious and inauspicious in characteristics. He's creator, he's also destroyer. He's the best yogi. Yogi means, Krishna says in 6th chapter of Gita, yogi means that one must be celibate. That's practice in Dhyana Yoga. You cannot be a family man and practice Dhyana Yoga properly. You must be celibate, he says. So he's the best of all yogis, and you see him there meditating. He can meditate for a long time like this. And yet, he's also the ideal householder. With Parvati, Mata, and Ganesha, and Kartikeya, Skanda, they make one big happy family. And all over India, people worship Mother Parvati and Lord Shiva for a good husband and a good wife. Because they are the ideal householders of this material world. How can a yogi be a householder? This is contradiction. Lord Shiva is most contradictory in every way. He's very easily angered, Mahadev. This is why he is given the job of destruction. Because he cannot destroy without some anger, some passion. It has to be there. If you're feeling completely relaxed and peaceful, you can't destroy anything. You have to get riled up. This is why Kshatriyas, they would go to the battlefield. You know, before they shot arrows, what they would do? They shoot insults at each other. You've seen this in Mahabharata? It's there in Bhagavatam also. When Lord Ram and Ravana, they meet, they're both shooting insults at each other. Lord Ram, he tells Ravana, you are no better than the urine coming from someone's body. Why? Because, you know, urine and semen, they come from the same place. And because you are clearly not a good son, therefore you are no better than the urine from your father. Like this, he's saying. Ravana also has very choice words for Lord Ram. And like this, they're sparring. Why? What's the point? because it's a built up anger. Right? You should feel angry at the other person. When Arjuna is hesitating to shoot the arrow at Karna, because Karna has no weapons, he's trying to get his wheel out of the ground. Then Lord Krishna, he reminds him, you forget the game of dice? You forget what he said for Draupadi? Called her a prostitute? And he starts reminding, all of a sudden, then Arjuna has no problem shooting the arrow. Destruction requires anger. It needs it. Mahadev, this is why Bhagavatam describes that he is the Lord's incarnation in the mode of ignorance. This doesn't mean he's ignorant himself, but it means he displays, he accepts the qualities of that mode in order to do his function, which is destruction of this world.
Rudra.
Yeah, Rudra. In the Vedas, he is called Rudra. The word Rudra means?
To cry.
One who makes others cry. Or one who cries himself, either way. Rudati, that means to cry. And so many prayers are there in the Vedas. I mean, Rig Veda, Yajur Veda. With that praise Lord Shiva, what are they praying to him? Please stay away from us. you're good, we know. But also easily angered. So someone who has got a quick temper like this, you know, you're afraid of him. This person can flip their lid at any point, and then what's going to happen? You don't know. So he's easily angered, Mahadev, but also easily pleased. And therefore he is called
Ashutosh.
Again, this is a contradiction. Like Ravana. There he is lifting Mount Kailash and shaking it and causing problems. But then, and Lord Shiva gets upset and crushes his hands. But then once he offers some nice prayers, Mahadev melts again. Says, okay, what do you want? Take anything you like. He's very easily pleased, very kind like this. There's a nice story in Bhagavatam, in Krishna book, of this demon named Bhasmasura. You know this story?
Yes.
And he wanted... he prayed to Lord Shiva, really a demoniac, this is how you don't worship Shiva, is very demoniac way, doing all these yajnas and sacrifices, and the final sacrifice that he was going to do was his own head. He held his head above the fire and cutting it off, I'm going to offer this to you. This is demoniac worship, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, in the mode of ignorance, the worship of the demons, which tortures the body. This is not how people in the mode of goodness worship. So, he's cutting off and Lord Shiva comes. He says, okay, fine. What do you want? Don't do this to yourself. And the demon says, I want to... whoever's head I put my hand on should explode. So normally, people put their hand on someone's head out of affection. Yes, you do this for your children. You put your hand on their head. Or the teacher does it for a student as an act of blessing. Right? So it's a very affectionate thing. So this is the quality of a demon, to take something so affectionate and turn it into destruction. so when I put my hand on my children's head, it can explode. That's a good idea. So Lord Shiva says, of course, he gives things. Very easily, he doesn't think twice. Easily pleased. He gives the boot, and immediately the demon says, ah, now let me test it out on Shiva. He runs and runs and runs. And Mahadev is running all throughout. So what to do? It's his own boon. It means it's as powerful, his blessing is as powerful as he is. So he's in real danger. And he runs and he runs and runs. And finally he runs through Vaikuntha. And Lord Vishnu says, what's happening, Mahadev? Why are you... You're not supposed to be doing this. What's going on? And he explains. And he says, don't worry. And Lord Vishnu takes the form of Mohini, of the beautiful woman. And he comes in front of Bhasmasura and says, you know, this Shiva, he's not trustworthy. He says so many things, but half the time they work and half the time they don't work. Before you make all this effort of running around the universe, chasing him, test it out first and make sure it's working, you know? And most of the time it doesn't. So beautiful, this lady is that Bhasmasura has completely lost his head, his brain. Okay, tell me what. Said, well, just put it on your own head and see if it works or not. And I said, okay. And of course, problem solved. The moon attack does work. So Mahadev is easily pleased and easily angered. He's creator, he's destroyer, he's householder, he's yogi, he's all auspicious, he's inauspicious, he's easily pleased, he's easily angered. He's the lord of all contradictions. All of this is part of his wonderful character. But the one thing that stands out in his character more than anything else, about which there is no contradiction, that is his devotion to Krishna. Bhagavatam says, it says, Vaishnavanam yatha shambhu. It says, like of rivers, the greatest is the Ganges. Of sacred scriptures, the greatest is Srimad Bhagavatam. So of all the Vaishnavas, the devotees of Lord Vishnu, the greatest is Shambhu, is Lord Shiva. And in fact, the most common way you see Lord Shiva described and depicted is always seated in meditation. Who is he meditating upon? You have to have something you're meditating. Why would you be meditating otherwise? So he worships Lord Shankarshana, Lord Vishnu in the form of Shankarshana, whose Shankarshana is in charge of this material world. So in Bhagavatam it's also described that there are 12 different Mahajans, the 12 great devotees who guide all of human society by their instructions. So, Narada, Vyasadeva, who gives us the scriptures, Narad Muni, who guides so many devotees, we see
Yamaraj
is there,
Bhishma,
Shukadeva Goswami,
Bhishma,
Janak Maharaj, Kapila, Bali Maharaj,
Bhishma.
But one of them in the list is also Shambhu, Lord Shiva. And in this way, he guides all of the devotees of the Lord to his lotus feet. So when we worship Lord Shiva, we have to know what we are looking for from him. He is capable of giving us a good life in this material world, no doubt. Very easily, actually, very quickly. Krishna says those who worship the demigods attain their results very quickly. It's not a big deal for him. We go to him, he'll give us an upgrade in our prison cell, basically. Nicer room, maybe our own TV, and better carpets, nicer meals. He can do that like this. It's not difficult for him. He's the master of the prison house. His wife is Durga. The word Durga means fort, fortress. She's the keeper of this jail. She's the keeper of this fortress. This is why she's called Durga. So for him, it's none of this is a problem. He'll give it like that. Whatever we want, and this is part of the danger in approaching Lord Shiva, is that it's too easy to get what we want. We think of this as a good quality. This is why people worship the devas. But it's actually a great risk for us. Because we don't have the slightest clue what's good for us half the time. We go to him, we come in front of Krishna, we stand in front of him, and we say, my Lord, I want to win the lottery. And Krishna, he says,
forget.
Yes. Yeah. That's the one thing I've heard Krishna actually say. He says, forget. Why? Because he says, are you sure this is really good for you? Do you know what happens to 9 out of 10 lottery winners? They go bankrupt, they go crazy, they become paranoid. Is this, are you sure this is good for you? Yeah, I can manage. So, I'll give it to you when you're ready. You work hard, you then become Vanaprastha, you take sannyas, and then I'll give you hundreds of thousands of dollars. This is what Prabhupada said. He said, when I was a householder, he wasn't very successful in his business. A little bit, enough to maintain the family. As I tried and I tried and I tried, and not much success. And then I took sannyas, and hundreds of temples, Rolls Royces wherever he went, to see him in the airport, so much money flowing all directions. Right? So that's how Krishna works. Krishna says, I know what's good for you, that's what I'll give you. The danger in worshipping Lord Shiva that we have to be careful about is that that responsibility is on our own shoulders. We have to know what we're asking, otherwise like Bhasmasura, we ask something stupid and we will get it. And then we'll blow up our own selves. So, when we go to Mahadev, we have to approach him like we would approach any other great Vaishnava. As we would approach the great, our spiritual master. The way we would approach the greatest devotees of the Lord. And ask him only for one thing. Please show me the way to get Krishna. Give me devotion to Lord Krishna. That's how we have to ask. Then Mahadev is not only helpful, he is essential actually to our spiritual practice. Because if he is the greatest of all devotees, then our whole process is founded on the idea that we need to serve the Vaishnavas in order to get to Krishna. Yes, this is the basis of our idea, of our philosophy. And in fact, Lord Shiva, he says, that of all types of worship, Vishnu Aradhanam Param, he says, the greatest type of worship is worship of Vishnu. But greater than the worship of Lord Vishnu is the worship of the devotees of Lord Vishnu. That means Lord Shiva's worship, by the same logic. But we have to worship him as a devotee. This is why this prayer in Brahma Samhita is so nice, because it places him in relation to Lord. Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. That it is Govinda who is the object of worship. This is his greatest devotee, his manifestation as Shambhu. Let me offer my respectful obeisances. In fact, Brahma Samhita is so nice. Such a beautiful book. Because it has a prayer for every deva in there. If you want to worship Suryadev, you can pray to it. Yes, Chakshuresha Savita Sakalagrahanam Raja Samasta Suramurti Rashesha Teja Yes, Yajnaya Brahmati Sambhita Kala Chakro Govindam Adi Purusham Tamam. It's describing the glories of Suryadev. He's Kala Chakra, he's the wheel of time. Ashesha Teja, amazing power and brilliance is there. If we want to worship Lord Ganesha, the beautiful verse is there. We want to worship Durga, Shashti, Stiti, Pravesa, Adhana, Shakti, Reka. This verse is there. So we can worship all of these devas because they're all great devotees of the Lord. And none of them are greater than Lord Shiva. He's the best of all the Vaishnavas. But we have to approach it in that way. We have to approach him. And in fact, this is what pleases him the most also. Because he's a devotee, how can a devotee ever be happy if someone goes and calls him God? Then that person is not a devotee. If someone went to Srila Prabhupada and says, actually, you are Krishna. You think Prabhupada could ever tolerate that? In the history of our movement, there's this time where some people were coming up with this idea, Prabhupada is actually Krishna, he's coming. Prabhupada was so upset. Means it was the one time. Prabhupada rarely removed anyone from the movement. He never actually did. He was always ready to forgive. But that was the one time he was ready, then and there, to say, forget it, you're out. But fortunately, then they changed their minds and so on and so forth. But this is something completely intolerable to a devotee. Even Mahaprabhu, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he was playing the role of a devotee. Anytime someone says, you are Krishna, you immediately cover his ears and go away from that place. So Lord Shiva is not happy when the demons go on worshipping him as the Supreme Lord. This is why they are demons. But he is extraordinarily pleased when we see him as a devotee of the Lord. This is his relationship with the Lord. This is what he enjoys. This is what he's proud of. That yes, I'm a servant of Lord Krishna. So in this way, when we approach Mahadev, we get all kinds of wonderful benefits in our spiritual life. And the best example of this is actually Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. When Mahaprabhu took his tour of South India, for 6 years he traveled after taking sannyas all around South India, visited great temples like Srirangam and Tirupati and all of these places, Simhachalam, Ahovilam. He also visited temples for Lord Shiva. And he went, Krishna's Kaviraj describes, he danced in ecstasy before Lord Shiva. All the major temples to Lord Shiva that are still existent in South India, Mahaprabhu visited, and he danced and he glorified Lord Shiva and everything. So we see from his own example that a Vaishnava should honor Lord Shiva. He could have very easily ignored them. There are so many temples of Vishnu there. But he made it a point to go there. It wasn't that someone else was going, so he went out of formality. No, he went to worship, to honor. Because a devotee understands that Krishna is everything. He's the Lord of everyone. And so everyone is connected in some way to the Lord. There's no reason why we should dishonor any deva or any other devotee or any person from any religious tradition. No. Because Krishna is the Lord. Therefore, if he's truly the Lord of everyone, he's also the Lord of all of these devas. And therefore, they are worthy of respect, just like anyone else's. This is our Vaishnava understanding of Mahadeva. That he is practically Krishna himself. Just a little different, that's all. Just a little different. He comes for a very specific function, which is looking after this material world. And because he holds the keys to this prison house, therefore we can pray to him as a servant of the Lord to help us get out of here, to help us strengthen our relationship with Krishna. And he himself is very much aware of this connection. There's one more nice story in Bhagavatam. When Krishna takes the form of Mohini to delude the demons, after the churning of the ocean, he wants to give all the amrit to the devas, to the demigods, and none of it to the demons. And so he takes the form of Mohini. Well, after this is all over, this whole leela, Lord Shiva, he prays to the Lord that I want to see this wonderful form of yours. Please show it to me. And so the Lord agrees, and he shows this form as Mohini to Mahadev. And Lord Shiva, he becomes totally bewildered, completely attracted to her. And he runs around this world chasing after her as she's running Mohini, or after him, Lord Vishnu. Even though Mother Parvati is seated right next to his side. And when he returns from this whole thing, comes to his senses and comes back, he says something very wonderful. He turns to Parvati and he says, you know, I'm not embarrassed at what just happened. But normally this is a situation of great embarrassment. And your wife is there and you're not very impressive. So normally you think, oh, you must be really embarrassed. Right? But he turns to Parvati and he says, look, I'm not embarrassed. I have just witnessed the Lord's internal energy. This is not Maya that attracted me. This is the internal energy of the Lord. His internal potency. Why is it not Maya? Well, Maya is seated right there. She's Durga Devi, she's Parvati. Right? So there's no question of him being controlled or going crazy, because he's always with her. This is his wife. He says, this is the internal energy of the Lord, and there is no living entity in this world that can stay beyond the control of the Lord's yoga mantra. This is the Lord's, this is Krishna's power by which he controls the entire world. not just the material world, but the spiritual world also. All of the devotees, Mahatmanas Supamparta, Daivim Prakriti Mashana, every devotee of the Lord is controlled by the Lord's Yoga Maya. The fact that I was controlled by her and bewildered by her, this is nothing surprising and nothing embarrassing either. So Mahadev, he knows his position. Right? He is very, in fact, not only does he know it, but he's very proud of his position as the Lord's greatest servant. He doesn't think himself greatest, of course. That's not the quality of Vaishnava. But to think of himself, to be proud of his master, this is the quality of a devotee. And he's very proud of his master. So, so many other stories and so on of Lord Shiva that I could tell. But I want to pause here and see if anyone has questions or comments or any direction that you'd like to explore further. Come on.
You can elaborate on the concept of the person of Gopishwar Mahadev, because that's a very Vrindavan connected,
yes.
and Lord Shiva is he kind of guards. Maybe you can talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, so this is a nice point. Gopishwar Mahadev in Vrindavan. Actually, Vrindavan is the land of Lord Krishna, yes? But if you go to Vrindavan, you find that Lord Shiva is actually a very, very important presence in all of Braj. Everywhere you go, in any direction, you find a very important Shiva Linga presence in Braj. And this is because Mahadev serves as the protector of Vrindavan, of Braj, of the holy town. And there are four important deities of Mahadev, the most famous of whom is Gopishwar Mahadev, where he's called the Lord of the Gopis. And the story that is told goes like this. One time, Lord Shiva, he wanted to experience the Lord's rasa dance. You know, Lord Shiva, I already mentioned, he's Nataraj, right? He's the king of dances. He is the most expert dancer there is. And yet, Krishna, when he does his rasa dance, he enchants the whole three worlds by his dance. And so Mahadev, naturally, he has some attraction to participate in the dance. But in that dance, the only people who can participate are gopis. And so he has to become a gopi. And so there's actually two different versions of this. But in one version, he goes to Yamuna. And in the other version, he goes to
Purnamashi.
She helps him. She says, come here. And they take a dip in the waters. And the first version is Yamuna, and the other one is Kusum Sarovar. And he takes a dip in this lake or in the river. And he comes out in this beautiful form as a gopi. The other gopis are of Purnamasi. They do all the makeup very nicely and decorate this new gopi very nicely. And then he can enter the Lord's rasa dance. And there he dances with such expertise and so much enthusiasm that all the gopis are wondering, who is this special gopi who's just come? We can't keep up with him. You know, Lord Shiva's style of dance is a little different than this variety. When he does his dance, well, the universe is destroyed. So he goes on to dance very expertly, but also very energetically. So he's in this way he gets to enter the Lord's rasa dance. This is very significant, because even Lakshmi Devi cannot enter the rasa dance. There's another story of how she wants to enter, but she cannot, right? Because she has still the sense that I am this Aishwarya sense. I'm the mistress. She is the, you know, she's queen. She's queen, and so she cannot. But Lord Shiva, and this is the point, you see it, he's fundamentally a devotee, he's a Vaishnava. And so he has the mood, not of master, but of servant. Whereas Lakshmi Devi, she's not servant, she is queen. She is the mistress of this whole creation. So Lord Shiva can enter the rasa dance and participate. This is why you can go and visit Gopishwar Mahadev. He's the protector of the dham. And anyone who wants to go to Vrindavan and be successful in their pilgrimage must take shelter of Lord Shiva there at Gopishwar Mahadev and pray to him for entrance, because he entered, he can help us enter also into the Lord's Vrindavan Lila. And there you will see the only place where they dress Lord Shiva as a gopi. And they'll put the red cloth and the veil around him and decorate him in beautiful eyes and nice makeup and everything. Like that. So, nice reminder. Thank you. What else?
About his leelas with the prachetas and devotees.
Yeah. Okay, that's a little bit of a long story. I'll just wait a few minutes and see if there's other questions. Otherwise, we'll get too far down. Yes, go ahead.
I had so far as I remember that he had prayed to Lord Shiva. Lord Ram had prayed to Lord Shiva before he went to Lanka. There is Rameshwar.
Right.
So what is the significance of that?
Yeah, so that place is there. That account is not there in Valmiki Ramayana, but it is described in Tulsidas Ramayana, in Ramcharitmanas. And we often find that the Lord, he enjoys worshipping, honoring his own devotees. This is something that we find in Krishna Lila, we find in Ram Lila, in any form that the Lord takes. They have a very the Lord, he takes great pleasure in becoming servant of his devotees. You know, in Krishna Lila, when there was the yagya, Rajasuya yagya, then Lord Krishna took this particular role of greeting the guests and taking care of them in a very menial way of service, because he likes to serve his devotees. He became the charioteer of Arjun, we know, which is a very subservient position. The charioteer's role is to look after the comfort and the safety of the warrior in every way, and be commanded by him. So Krishna, he enjoys this type of work. He's master anyway, the whole three worlds worship him. So he's not that impressed by that type of thing. It's always the case. Rather, he enjoys making himself a servant of his devotees. And so we find this in Lord Ram's pastimes also, that before he goes to Lanka and other important junctures of Ram Lila, then he prays to Lord Shiva for protection, for success, for help in the onward journey. Yeah.
Even when during Mahabharata Yudha, like when Arjuna had to fight the Kauravas, Krishna had told Arjuna to take shelter of Durga Maya,
yes,
so that she can grant him all the weapons.
Yes.
When Arjuna said, no, why should I do that since you are with me? But then Krishna said, okay, no, you have to do it because that's where you get all your energy. So that time, Arjuna had taken shelter of Durga Maya. That was one event, right?
Yes. Yes. So this is exactly the point, that delegation is Krishna's strength. Right? He tells him to take shelter of Durga Devi. He gives the creation to Brahma to do. He tells what was the example that we just gave of
Nilkanth?
Yeah. He tells the demigods to go to Mahadev to drink poison. Yes, even though they come to him when the poison comes out of the ocean. He says, no, you go to Mahadev and you ask him, Lord Shiva, ask him to drink the poison, to take care of the poison that comes out. So, showing the strength and the ability of his devotees and delegating the task to him, this is Krishna's strength. In fact, it's the strength of any leader or manager. It's the ability not to micromanage, but to delegate. So Krishna encourages his devotees to go. But just see also the ideal example of Arjuna. This is the mood of a devotee. Arjuna is very clear in that circumstance. My Lord, you are here. I don't need anything else. But on Krishna's request, he says, I will go to whoever you ask. Yes. So this has to be our mood towards Lord Shiva and towards all the devas. That Krishna is the sum and substance of all creators and all leaders in this world. He is the supreme, Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. But for his service, I will go and offer my respects to anyone who is deserving of it.
Yes.
So that Arjuna's mood is actually very ideal in that circumstance.
And also there was one incident, like when Krishna had gone to Indraloka to get the Parijat tree, right? Sure. Satya Mama demanded that, and Krishna was saying, no, you should not have it. And then Indra was not willing to give that tree so that she could perform her service. I mean, she was trying to do something, right? So Krishna had been there once, and then he was ready to fight with Indra. Mm-hmm. So I had read about that incident, what happened, like, there was a pause after the war, like, in the evening, and it was Mahashivratri that time, and Krishna said, like, I have to pray to Lord Shiva. So here the incident says, like, even Krishna used to worship Lord Shiva.
Yeah, that I don't know where that account
is
from.
It is in Bhagavatam only.
It's certainly, I don't remember that particular story, I'm sorry. So I can't say so much more. But like I was saying in response to Mataji's question, this is not very unusual.
Right.
This is not very unusual. When he comes as Lord Ram, when he comes as Lord Krishna, in all of these forms. In fact, Bhagavatam describes that every morning Krishna would wake up and he would meditate on himself. And so Krishna, he's I mean, as we're describing, Mahadev is not different from Krishna himself. There's no great surprise in the fact that Krishna is recognizing Lord Shiva. This is not a big surprise because the two are practically identical in terms of their nature. But in terms of their function, they're very different. That's the essence of the idea. Right? Same in substance, very different in function. Questions?
Lord Shiva is the greatest devotee, and he, as you said, he has the keys to exit out of this material world. So when devotees don't worship Lord Shiva, are we offending him when we go directly to Krishna, or stepping over him?
Well, the point is, if devotees reject the worship of Shiva, yes, then we're offending Krishna. If we say, oh, Lord Shiva, oh, I don't worship him, he's I'm not a Shaivite, I'm a Vaishnava, I'm not going to bow to him, then yes, this is a cause for great offense. But at the same time, we have been given a particular sadhana for worship. And that sadhana involves primarily worshipping or honoring the spiritual master and those in our line of disciplic succession. So there is a line of Vaishnava disciplic succession that comes from Lord Shiva also. Ours comes from Lord Brahma through Vyasadeva. And so this is why we respect the devotees, the teachers, as representatives of Vyasa. So we call Vyasa Puja, this is called Vyasasan. But there's another line of Vaishnavas that comes from Lord Shiva as their primary teacher instead of Lord Brahma. This is our particular sadhana that we've been given. So that's why in our sampradaya we don't have like a daily practice of worship of Lord Shiva. There are so many Vaishnavas that one could worship. Lord Shiva is there, but also Lord Brahma is there, and Lakshmi Devi is there, and all the devas practically. Surya Devi is also there. All of these are worthy of our worship. But who we worship on a day-to-day basis, this is guided by our disciplic succession. In other words, by the particular sadhana that is passed down to us through parampara. And that sadhana that we have received is a process of honoring the spiritual master and the guru parampara, going all the way back to Lord Vyasadeva. Right? And so that is our day-to-day sadhana. But if the opportunity arises to honor Lord Shiva by visiting his temple, by observing Shivaratri and so on, and we refuse to honor him, then this is an offense. This is a great offense.
In that connection, I would also want to ask that we have Advaita Acharya, who we worship every day,
yes.
And he's Mahavishnu and Lord Shiva, and so he's not like we're excluding. He's
That's a
somewhat,
good point.
And so he's not missing from our altar or from our daily worship in that sense.
That's a good point. Yes, in the Pancha Tattva, then all the different aspects of Godhead are there. Lord Vishnu, the Supreme Lord, is there as Mahaprabhu, Krishna himself, and then his brother Balaram is there, right, as Shankarshan or Nityananda Prabhu, and there's the living entity, Jiva Tattva, is Shiva's Thakur. then Shakti or Srimati Radhani or Rukmini Devi is there as Kadada Pandit. But also Lord Shiva is present. Yes, Lord Shiva is present. Mahavishnu/Sadashiva means the form of Lord Shiva that is the first form that is taken right when this contact happens that I was talking about. He touches the material energy. He becomes Sadashiva. That's his, the supreme form of Lord Shiva, his highest manifestation, the eternal manifestation. This is why it's called Sada. Sadashiva is there. And that is Advaitacharya. So you're right in that he's there in the Panchatattva also.
Can you explain the difference between Sadashiva, Shiva, and Rudra?
So these are all different aspects or manifestations that occur for different reasons. So Sadashiva is the original form of Lord Shiva who appears particularly for the purpose of creation, okay, for creation of this world. Sadashiva is not the one who dances and does the destruction. That form is there as Rudra. Rudra is the Lord's angry form. And there are actually 11 Rudras are there. And these are all angry forms of the Lord. There even more angry forms are there, like Bhairava, for example, which are extremely, extremely angry and very dangerous, and tend to be liked only by those who like these darker forms of worship. So, in this way, and Lord Shiva is there. This is the generic name for him. Particularly when he's seated with Mother Parvati, then he's Shiva. He's very auspicious, very calm, and very pleasing, very domestic, like that. So these are different manifestations, different aspects of his personality, of his nature, that he shows for different purposes. Just like Krishna is there, then Vishnu is there, Garbha Dakshaya Vishnu, Shira Dakshaya Vishnu. So Lord Shiva, Vishnu takes all these forms for different reasons. So Lord Shiva does also. He's there in various parts of the creation.
And Sadashiva also resides in Vaikuntha?
Just below. He's actually on the border of the material and the spiritual worlds. Haridham, Maheshadham, and then Devidham. So he's between this material world, Devidham, and Haridham, Vaikuntha. Just in between. He's the gatekeeper. Right? He's in between this. So when we go to the spiritual world, we have to go through Maheshadham. We have to go through Lord Shiva's planet. And this is why, if we're on bad terms with Lord Shiva, there's not much chance of us. Someone else had their hand up here, yes?
Yeah, Prabhuji, usually the Shiva devotees, they look like three horizontal lines. So is there any significance or any stories there for you?
The three horizontal lines, I don't know actually. There must be, because we have significance for the two vertical lines. But I don't know.
Maybe it's in the same Puran.
Yes, there is a quick story.
There is a story about that.
Okay. What is the story?
Lord Siva's greatest Vaishnava, and he used to have Vaishnava Tilak at one time. And then his goblins or his ghosts, and they were all putting Vaishnava Tilak, following him. And then one time they found out there was this ghost and all, they are creating troubles and mischief. And they should be destroyed. And then they approached Lord Vishnu. And Vishnu said, okay, I'm going to send my chakra to destroy them. And then chakra went and came back. He said, what happened? He said, all they are waiting for. So Lord Vishnu has got to Lord Siva. And then tell them, you should change your Tila. So he made this Tila. And then chakra went and destroyed
them. So the moral is, if we want our head sliced off, we
that's funny. Triple.
From Vaishnava.
Otherwise,
he's a great Vaishnava. Why
should he have triple?
Vaishnava,
we are always Vaishnava. But because of this,
we change. Yeah. He has the three lines. Thank you very much for that nice story. He has three lines across, and then he has this third eye also that's present here, right? Trinetra, that he's called. And when he opens that third eye, then it's usually both ill for whoever he sees using it.
Can you briefly explain what is the essence of Shivratri? How did it originate? And the second question that is most, you know, in India, people drink the special nectar called bhang.
Mm.
What is the essence of that?
So, the first question, what is the essence of Shivaratri? I was stressing out during the whole flight from Salt Lake to Newark, worrying that someone would ask me this question. So, because I have heard different things about what Shivaratri is, the essence of Shivaratri, but I don't want to speak from hearsay, as in I don't know based on Shastra what it is. In India you hear many things. It can be the day that Shiva and Parvati married, or it's the day that he appeared in a particular story, or different accounts are there. Does anyone know more definitively what is?
Encyclopedia says it's marriage of Parvati.
Marriage. Yeah, that's the most common one, is marriage of Shiva and Parvati. In fact, there's a whole story about this, the Kumara Sambhava by Kalidas. It's a very nice account of this story. And Prabhupada, he quotes from Kumara Sambhava quite a bit, actually, in his lectures. If you, he talks about how Lord Shiva, he's shown as a complete Gita there, a completely self-controlled person in that particular account of their marriage. So, yeah, that's the extent of my knowledge about Shivaratri. But in terms of your second question, as to this bhang, so Prabhupada speaks about this quite a bit. And this is basically an imitation of Lord Shiva. That Lord Shiva, he drank poison. And this is, he, like I said, he does all kinds of amazing things. And improper things also, from a worldly perspective. And so some of his followers feel, well, if Lord Shiva drinks poison, then let us also take this poison. If he can take a controlled substance, I'll take also. And then they enjoy this bhang. You know? But Prabhupada, he explains many times, he says that we should never imitate the great souls. In fact, this is there in Bhagavatam also, that the great, those who are Ishwar, in the 10th canto of Bhagavatam, when the Rasleela happens, then Parikshit Maharaj, he asks, he says, how is it that Krishna is dancing with other men's wives in the middle of the night? Is this not improper? And he gives, Shukadeva Goswami gives full explanation, but one of the things he says there is that those who are Ishwaras can never be imitated. If you are a master, controller, then you try to imitate them and you'll run into problems. So, because Prabhupada says this is hypocrisy, Lord Shiva drank an ocean of poison, why are you taking only this much? Take more? We cannot, right? So we're taking it, we're imitating insofar as it's fun for us, but not doing anything useful for anyone. He saved the world. What is our bhang saved? Nothing, right? You become useless for the world. Yeah. So similarly, people like to imitate Krishna doing the rasa dance. Now I will be sahajiya and I'll dance. Krishna, Prabhupada says, well, then you lift Govardhan Hill also and protect people from hurricanes and storms and so on. But you cannot do that. So this is the problem, it's imitation. And Lord Shiva, he knows this, right? He knows that, like I said, his followers come in two categories. There are those who are basically in the mode of ignorance, and Lord Shiva, he tolerates them because he wants to help them. Right? On the other hand, there are those who are truly wise, truly enlightened, even liberated. These are the great yogis who take instruction from him.
So, Prabhu, like we say that Lord Brahma, there is many Brahmas and many universes, one Brahma for every universe. Similarly, Lord Shiva in each and every universe?
No. I mean, well, yes. He manifests in every universe. He's there. So, Lord Shiva is present. He has, like I said, Rudra, and so many forms are there. So, he's involved and present in every universe. But ultimately, the person Shiva is one. Okay, there's no multiple Shivas. This Sadashiva, he's present in the border of the spiritual creation and the material creation. And that's just one border. It means the entire spiritual world, three-fourths, and the entire material world. That's where Lord Shiva is located. Right? And so that's why no one can become Shiva, because there's only one Shiva. As in, there's one Shiva Tattva only. There's one reality. Brahma and so on is not, there's no Brahma Tattva, there's just Jiva Tattva. So Jivas are multiple in category, and so you can have many different Jivas in each. So the difference between Brahma and Shiva is that Brahma is a product of creation, whereas Shiva is the cause of creation. Brahma is the first being who is created in this material world. He comes out from the lotus growing from Lord Vishnu's navel, Garbhodaksha Vishnu. So he is created. Lord Shiva is creator. Right? He is Aham Bija Pradapita. He is the seed-giving father. So there's therefore a big difference. You can have many Brahmas, but Shiva Tattva is only one. Right? He is very unique. This is why there's a story in Bhagavatam where he does... where he doesn't... Shiva doesn't stand up to greet...
Daksha Prajapati.
That they're all there in the assembly, and when Brahmaji walks in, into the, all the devas are present, and Brahma walks in, and everyone stands, because Brahma is the grandfather of the whole creation, except Lord Shiva. And Daksha, who is Brahma's son, he takes offense at this. And this is the beginnings of their difficult relationship. He starts to criticize Lord Shiva and say, you know, who is this? He's completely uncouth and doesn't know any type of proper behavior and so on. But he doesn't realize that Lord Shiva does not need to stand for anyone. Right? He's not, in terms of this material world, in terms of Leela, he appears from Brahma's forehead, Bhagavatam describes. And the when Brahma is angry at the Kumaras, he emerges. In terms of his tattva, in terms of his essence, he is much beyond Brahma. Brahma is only Jiva, whereas Shiva is his own category. Shiva tattva. Okay. Yes.
Lord Shiva dancing, lifting the body of Mother Sati, and then so many parts that fell down and became Shakti Pita,
yes,
like Vaishnavi Devi. Is it true, or it is just mythology? In Gujarat also there is some place. So there are several Shakti Pitas, I don't know how many. But that is,
yes, the story is told. That this is part of the story of... actually, this Daksha story is a very, very long story. And it goes all the way from Daksha's, this incident that we were just talking about, to finally Daksha, Sati immolating herself because Daksha insults Shiva so much. Then Shiva getting upset at Daksha for this purpose and decapitating him, then putting on the goat's head. Then Daksha comes to his senses, but Lord Shiva is still so distraught because he Sati is gone. And so that's where that story comes. Now, I don't know the source of that story. I know that it is widely told all over India. My guess is probably it would be from one of the other Puranas, but I can't say for sure. It's not in Bhagavatam. But it must be there in the other Puranas, because you find these Shakti Pitas all over
India. Nine.
And it goes all the way from Assam to Gujarat to all over the country, practically speaking. There's major ones, there's minor ones. And then after that, he then becomes very, very... He decides to completely give up the world. And he goes into his cave to meditate. And will not talk to anyone, will not come out. And this is what gets the devas really worried, because the work of this universe of creation cannot go on unless Lord Shiva is there. And this is where the story of the Kumara Sambhava begins, that Kalidasa tells, of how the demigods then plot to get Lord Shiva out of his slumber, his meditation. And in the process of doing that, they send Kamadeva, Cupid, the god of love, and this is where Kamadeva tries to excite him to get him out of his meditation. And Lord Shiva gets upset. He opens his third eye. And this is why Kamadeva's body is burnt. And one of Kamadeva's names is Ananga, one who has no body. Right? And this is the great irony, that that demigod, Kama, who causes one person to be attracted to the body of another, causes this physical attraction in all living beings, from birds to animals to human beings, that demigod has no body himself, right? Because Lord Shiva burnt it to the ground. So you see his anger there also. And then Ananga comes back as Krishna's son. He gets the body again through Lord Krishna's mercy by becoming Pradyumna. So that's a very, very long story. And there are so many parts and pieces of that story that are expanded out in more detail. But it goes, one can keep going and going and going with that one particular incident regarding Mahadev. So I don't know more in terms of the source of that story, but I have heard it many places. Okay, it's coming to 9 o'clock, actually it's past. So we'll stop here. the greatest devotees of Lord Shiva, some of them, the greatest poets and so on, have come from South India, some of the most famous temples also. And I've heard that we have a South Indian feast today also. So we can relish that and meditate on Mahadev. And those who really want to get the full experience can take their place outside. I'll be enjoying the South Indian. So thank you all very much for your day.